come to worship this morning. We are so glad that you have joined us. The building may be closed, but our church is alive and well. As we gather together, sharing the gospel and Christ's love wherever you are, to whoever is near you. We are so grateful for those who have continued to support this ministry of our congregation, whether it's through prayer or reaching out to people by phone or FaceTime, or by continuing to give financial support. We are grateful. Thank you. Assisting with worship today from their homes are Pastor Ben, Ruth Benning, and myself, Pastor Nikki. So now let us continue with the greeting.
Alleluia. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia. Praise the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ.
God gave us new life and hope by raising Jesus from the dead. In baptism, God claims us as God's own.
God called us from our darkness into the light of this new day. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness shall not overcome it. Please join me in the greeting with all of us saying this together and doing the hand and arm actions together. We begin with our arms up.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ,
the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. And also with you. Alleluia. Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia. Joined to Christ in the waters of baptism, we are raised with him to new life. Let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning you created us in your image and planted us in a well-watered garden.
In the desert,
you promised pools of water for the parched, and you gave us water from the rock. When we did not know the way, you sent the Good Shepherd to lead us to still waters.
At the cross, you watered us from Jesus' wounded side, and on this day, you shower us again with the water of life.
We praise you for your salvation through water,
for the water
in the font,
and for all water
everywhere. Bathe us in your forgiveness, grace, and love.
Satisfy the thirsty, and give us the life only you can give. To you be given honor and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.
I invite you now to mark your own forehead or somebody else's forehead in the shape of a cross with water, using the words, "Remember, you are God's child, and God loves you."
Let us pray. O God, your Son makes himself known to all disciples in the breaking of the bread. Open the eyes of our faith that we may see him in his redeeming work, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Our Gospel reading for this morning is from the Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 24th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Now on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them, but their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" Jesus asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him." Then Jesus said to them, "Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?" Then, beginning with Moses and all of the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying,
"Stay with us, because it is almost evening, and the day is now nearly over." So he went in to stay with them. And when he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?" That same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and found the 11 and their companions gathered together. And they were saying, "The Lord has indeed risen, and he has appeared to Simon." Then they told what had happened on the road, and how he had been made known to them in the breaking of the bread. This is the gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Easter is here! Now what? I found myself asking this question rather frequently over these past 2 weeks. The tomb is empty! Now what? Christ has indeed risen from the dead! Now what? So much of our church life in the first quarter of the year is pointed toward Easter Sunday. Lent is focused on it. Holy Week is fixed on it. Usually, Easter brings with it the chance for us to shout and sing and play trumpets and exuberantly praise God for the gift and promise of new life. Even on years when Easter is early and snow still covers the ground, the day itself is a day of rejoicing, of looking ahead, of imagining the future. And personally, it marks the finish line of the Lenten marathon and the sprint that is the Triduum, the 3 days of Jesus' death and resurrection. Easter marks a chance to take a breath and a needed break. But not this year. This year, the slog of Lent morphed into something else. And yes, Easter Sunday happened, and the snow that came on that day has melted, and warm temperatures are finally giving us a real taste of spring. But it doesn't feel like much has changed. We're still stuck in this weird in-between time. The resurrection has happened, but we're still waiting for it to kick in. It's remarkably similar to what the two disciples experienced in our gospel story. The resurrection had already happened. They were already living into the hope of a new future. After all, Jesus, the dead man himself, now raised from the grave, was actually there, walking with them. The future was present. But at the same time, they didn't realize that Jesus was raised. So they were still waiting. And on top of that, they didn't even know that they were waiting for anything. I mean, they didn't believe Jesus when he told them that he was going to die and be raised, so they didn't know that they were waiting for Jesus to come back. It was in this complex mixture of emotions, including the entirely ridiculous report that Jesus wasn't dead, that he actually showed up. Jesus asked the two of them pointed questions, questions that provoked them to be honest about what they were feeling. And with their defenses worn down by shock, utterly overwhelmed by everything that had happened, they blurted out their truth. "But we had hoped." It was in their conversation on the road with the unexpectedly and impossibly raised Jesus that they finally spoke the deep dread that had been plaguing their hearts for 3 days. "But we had hoped." Those agonizingly desperate words exposed dreams that were now left in tatters. "But we had hoped." In reading these words this past week,
I felt seen. They speak to my current reality all too well. How many things had I been hoping for, dreaming about, that were now dashed? Trips and conferences? Postponed or canceled. Random drives up to the cities to go to the zoo or the science museum or even the Mall of America? Out of the question. Eating at a restaurant? Forget about it. My days now consist of trying to do work while also trying to help my kids with school, of moving to the other side of the street if someone is walking toward me on the sidewalk, of speaking to people through my computer screen, hoping that the internet connection doesn't fizzle out. I watch the news looking for signs that the rate of infections and rate of deaths is slowing. I listen to the governor's daily reports, straining to hear refrains of good news. But like those two disciples, who are so emotionally drained and overwhelmed that they can't even recognize Jesus standing right there in front of them, I struggle to see the new life promised by Easter. Which, strangely enough, is why this gospel story gives me hope. Because even though Jesus was right there, he didn't magically give the two of those disciples understanding that it was him. He didn't magically make them forget what had happened. He didn't magically make it all better. Instead, he walked with them. And he listened to them. And he spoke the truth to them. And when night fell, he stayed with them. And then he did the most Jesus thing ever. He took bread, and he blessed it, and he broke it, and he gave it to them. And their eyes were opened. And they could see. Siblings in Christ, our road to Emmaus is long. And the truth is, we don't even know how long it is. But we do not walk alone. That's the promise Jesus makes to us in this story. We do not go alone. Despite the loneliness we may feel, despite the physical distance between us, despite our isolation, we are not alone. Even if we can't recognize it right now, because we are so emotionally drained and overwhelmed, we are not walking this path alone. And that gives me hope. A hope for a future that is already here, even though we can't see it yet. Because one day Jesus will do his Jesus thing, and our eyes will be opened, and we'll realize that our hearts have been burning this whole time. Alleluia, Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Thank you.
with the whole church. Let us confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father, Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Uplifted by the promised hope of healing and resurrection, we join with the people of God in all times and places in praying for the church, the world, and all who are in need. For those whose hearts are fervent with love for your gospel, that they are empowered to tell the story of your love in their lives wherever they are, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For the diverse natural world, for jungles, prairies, forests, valleys, mountains, and for the wild and endangered animals who call these spaces home, that they are nurtured and protected. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For all who call upon your healing name, give rest, stay with us, and walk with the caregivers, the hungry, the lonely, the despairing. Today we especially pray for Keith, Melissa, Tim, Laura, Chris, Jeanette, Bonnie, Marsha, and those we name now in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For the faith-forming ministries of this church, as we learn how to worship together and be the body of Christ in this new time, give us strength. For those who are learning a whole new way to do their jobs, give us guidance. For those who work tirelessly to provide for all, give us peace. And for those who are grieving the loss of someone or something, give us hope. Surround us all in your love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
With bold confidence in your love, Almighty God, we place all for whom we pray into your eternal care through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Alleluia! Christ is risen!
Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia.
The peace of the risen Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Please share a sign of Christ's peace. You are now invited to spend time sharing a low and a high from the past week with those around you. If you are by yourself and feel comfortable doing so, you are invited to post your low and your high as a comment. In fact, everyone is invited to post their lows and highs as a comment. Please take a few minutes now to share.
Thank you.
We are grateful for the overflowing generosity of all those who participate in our congregation's ministry. Your continued financial support, prayers, and acts of service enable us to share Christ's love and form faith from birth to senior saints. Even though we are not presently gathering in person, we invite you to continue living into the faith practices of giving to the ministry that God has called us to. You may give online by visiting our website, www.rochesteroslc.org, by participating in automated giving or simply giving, or by mailing your gift to the church office, 2124 Viola Road, Northeast Rochester, Minnesota, 55906. Again, thank you for your continued generosity and for the love of Christ that you share with the world. We need that love now more than ever. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. God, our provider, you give us this meal to remind us of Jesus' love. Thank you, God.
Thank you, God.
God, our Savior, you give us this meal to remind us that you are always with us. Thank you, God.
Thank you, God.
God, our life, you give us this meal to remind us to share your love with others. Thank you, God.
Thank you, God.
In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this for the remembrance of me." Before meals, we pray. Let us pray as Jesus has taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
receive the communion blessing. The body and blood of our risen Savior, Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Life-giving God, you have fed us with your word, and our hearts burn within us. Through this meal, you have opened us to your presence. Help us to share the gifts of Easter with all in need. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
May the one who brought forth Jesus from the dead raise you to new life, fill you with hope, and turn your mourning into dancing. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Amen.
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 Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia.
Be at peace at home or wherever you are. Share the good news of Christ.
Thanks be to God.
Amen.